don't even know how you could walk over here after singing like that. Just go ahead and do this. I mean, you gave it all you got.
I'm gonna take off running.
I know. I've had one of those moments a while ago.
Is this clean water?
Yes, ma'am.
I'm a little bit OCD.
No, it's... No, it's fine.
Oh, no, you spit in it?
No, I didn't. Somebody else did.
Well, Lord bless you.
Yeah, I know, right? Isn't that the truth? Christy, I just think that you're fantastic. I love your heart. I love your heart for the Lord. I love what you do. It's excellence.
Thank you.
We're just delighted that you are here with us.
Well, I'm excited to be here.
I know. Tell us what's going on. What you got cooking up?
Well, the song I just did and one I'll be doing in a minute are on my brand new album. It just came out last week.
Look at this.
Mm-hmm. It's called Hymns, Songs of Hope and Faith. And it's just me and my incredible piano player, Christopher Phillips. They're contemporary arrangements of classic hymns.
Yeah, I know Chris.
Yeah, he's great.
Oh, he's fantastic. But this is wonderful. It's a hymns project. Mm-hmm. I need thee every hour. There is a fountain, amazing grace. Rock of ages, turn your eyes upon Jesus. How great thou art. The old rugged cross, I'd rather have Jesus. God will take care of you softly and tenderly. Great is thy faithfulness. What a great compilation. What a great compilation.
Yeah, I've wanted to do this for a long time, you know, because these are the songs that I walked down the aisle to and that
right.
I saw, you know, family members accept Christ walking down the aisle to. And so, you know, there's so many great hymns. And when I was trying to decide, I thought, well, which ones touched my heart, you know, as a 12-year-old little girl
right.
in that little Baptist church in South Texas. And then, of course, I asked my daddy what he wanted, and I did what he wanted because I always do what my daddy wants.
Well, that's a good thing, too. You know, what is your favorite on this record?
Oh, my goodness. Probably I'd rather have Jesus.
Yeah. George Beverly Shea.
Mm-hmm.
Pin the music to that.
Right.
Yeah, fantastic song.
Yeah, and it's, you know, well, you know, because you've recorded that song.
Back a long time ago.
Yeah.
When you was a little girl.
No, I wasn't. But I like the way you think. But when I sing that song, it's so hard for me to not start crying.
Yeah.
In the middle of it, because, you know, I broke down crying in the studio doing the song. Because you think about all the things in our lives that that try to take precedence over God. And, you know, whether it's concerns about a job or family, you know, some of them are good things. You know,
yeah.
like my husband, I want to have a baby.
Right.
You know, and that's what I thought of in the studio. I thought, can I say I'd rather have Jesus more than having a child?
Yeah, yeah.
And yes, but it took a little bit of struggling. You know, I'll be honest with you. You're thinking it's something you want with your whole being. But nothing is worth anything if you don't have the Lord.
Yeah.
You know, and if you don't have peace.
Right.
A million children aren't going to make you happy. $1 million aren't going to make you happy.
Right.
So, and I know that at the end of the day, but it's kind of a call to conscience for me every time I sing it to really examine my heart. And is there anything that's trying to come above Christ?
And that's a way, you put it in such a way for us to really look at who Jesus is to us.
Mm-hmm.
Is he really, truly everything?
Yeah.
And that's the way you sing it. On this record, that's the way you present it,
yeah.
Because that's the heart. That's what was going through your mind. That's what came out of your mouth during that time. Yes, mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I'd rather have Jesus.
Yeah.
I can't wait to hear that.
Well,
that's,
I'm excited
that's amazing.
For you to hear it.
That's fantastic. Now, I know that you've been traveling a lot. You're on the road. You got a lot going on. I mean, we could talk about your family forever. You did the hymns record.
Uh-huh.
Now, okay, so tell me, when did you decide you wanted to do Christian music?
Well, that's something I actually fought. as a child.
Right.
And through high school, when there would be prophecies that I would be in Christian music, it'd make me mad because I would think, no, I'm going to be the next Loretta Lynn.
You know? Or Barbara Mandrell.
Well, or the next Barbara Mandrell, yeah. Now I just wear clothes.
Now, yeah. But, now, listen, we need to stop right here just for a second. For those that don't know, tell them.
Well, Barbara is my mother-in-law.
Yeah.
Yeah, I married her oldest son.
I don't know why we hadn't already got to that, but we've just taken our time, aren't we?
Well, yeah, and my daddy is a dentist, so I tell Matt he married me for the free dental, and I guess I married him for his mama's wardrobe.
Yes, fantastic. I love her.
But yes, she's wonderful. But, you know, since I was 4 years old growing up in South Texas, I wanted to be a country singer.
Right.
And I love the Lord. In fact, I was the kid carrying my Bible to school. I was always witnessing to people. But I believed that I was supposed to be in country music.
Right.
And so I moved to Nashville at 18, went to Belmont University. As soon as I graduated from there, I signed my first publishing deal as a country songwriter, and then signed a recording contract with Giant Warner Brothers Records, and then signed with Sony Records. And everything was going the way I'd planned. You know, I was getting to play the Grand Ole Opry every month and had a song on the country charts. And then in 3 days, it was gone. I mean, on a Tuesday, my publishing deal of 10 years ended. And 2 days later, Sony was bought by RCA and they dropped me. And I can tell by the look on your face, it's just horror. It was horrible. It was.
I mean, what did you do?
Well, first I cried and nearly ate a whole bucket of fried chicken, but after
you
that...
Didn't. You didn't take your boots back home, I promise you, did you?
No. After that, I lost my apartment. I couldn't afford my apartment. I'd just broken up with a guy that I thought I was going to marry. I remember I just thought it was over. I moved in with a girlfriend from church, and at 4 a.m, I heard God speak to me out loud. It's the only time in my life I've heard him audibly. And he woke me up and said, I want you to sing for me. And I was terrified. But I know you don't argue with God. I mean, I discussed it with him. But I knew, you know, I'm not going to have any peace if I don't do what he wants. And do you know that a couple days later, my publisher in country music took me to lunch and said, how do you feel about being a Christian recording artist? I mean, this was a man who had no reason to say that. I owed him, his company, a lot of money in the other field, but it was just all over the place that that's what I was supposed to do. So I took a job at Dillard's and sold makeup because I had to pay the girl I was staying with. And when I wasn't selling makeup, I was writing songs. And I got, oh my goodness, that first year and a half, like over 40 of my songs got recorded by major Christian artists because he was all I could write about.
Yeah.
And it was just, it was really cool. I mean, I had a lot more success as a songwriter when I was slinging makeup than I did when I was a songwriter. But that's because God doesn't waste anything, you know? And he brought me my husband. Matt came into Dillard's. Hadn't seen him in 13 years at that point, and he asked me out, and we're married.
You tell me that ain't a good old song. Matt waltzed into Dillard's. I wrangled him up.
Yeah, but he doesn't like for me to not say that he was not buying makeup, so I need to say that.
Well, he was not buying makeup. I know Matt. He was not buying makeup. I hate it that our time, it flies so fast when we get together.
I know.
Because we can just chit-chat. And I want you to go get this new record, Hymns and Songs of Hope and Faith. It's fantastic. Since we're